Well, good morning, everyone, and welcome to the Fourth President's Symposium. I am very, very excited this morning because this symposium, the fourth, is entitled Creative Disruptions, Breaking Conventions, and Benefiting Students. The President's Symposium, for those of you who are new to the college, got its legs and the genesis of it happened from the 2015 college-wide recommendations on training and education here within the college. And you are one of 260 individuals who have signed up for today's event. And I really want to thank you for that, 260. When we started this 4 years ago, we had 107 attendees. And so I am just very, very excited about participation and your involvement in this. What I would like to do, though, is to help our presenters, especially our keynote presenter this morning, understand who is here. So for those of you who are part of the administrative and professional organization, would you applaud, please? For those of you who are here from the classified employees organization, would you applaud? Loudly and proudly, yes. And from the faculty organization, would you please applaud? Anyone that I have missed, would you applaud? Very good. What I would like to do now, though, is would the individuals who helped to plan this event, the work group, would they please stand for a moment? Everyone on the work group, stand proudly, please. Here we have two over here. Good. Very nice. Thank you. Cavill, if you wouldn't remind standing, please, Cavill. Ladies and gentlemen, Cavill Anderson who is our Director of Staff and Faculty Development. She's been responsible for these 4 years for facilitating this event. And Cavill, I especially want to thank you and recognize you for your leadership and your efforts to make this event, these events, a reality. And the flowers in front here are yours as a very small token of our appreciation for your efforts. Okay, so thank you very much. There are a few things that I want to make you aware of in your program that you received today. There are two changes. You did get to see the program schedule. There was a change on the program schedule. And then finally, I want to thank Christine Nowick. Is Christine Nowick here? Christine, thank you in the front. Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, a round of applause. Christine Nowick at the 11th hour is replacing Miles Miller, who unfortunately at the last moment informed us that he is not going to be available today. So Christine, in the 11th hour, I want to thank you for coming in here, and you're going to do a session, breakaway session 5, leading through change. So thank you very, very much. So as you can see, a lot of effort went into this program. We are going to have a variety of sessions, as you have seen, from disrupting departmental barriers to creating digital competency in teaching and learning, to women, gender, and social media, to a presentation from our Next Generation Task Force. There are many other seminar sessions that you'll be able to see in your book, but I think one of the things that I hope you personally get out of this is that you come to realize that change in higher education and here at HAC has already begun. It's underway, and I'm hoping that we'll be able to use the change that is already occurring here so that we'll be able to thrive as we look at this institution to meet the ever-changing needs of our students and our communities. You know, according to many studies that many of you have read, and I know that I'm reading, many organizations such as ours who do not innovate will not long survive. And so I think it's really important because we know the knowledge economy has changed the way education is delivered, is perceived, and is received. You know, we know that there are many educational providers in our service region who are coming after our students. So the landscape is changing. We know the changes that are going on at the federal and state level as well. And so I firmly believe the following. Surviving change will be predicated upon our ability to understand what is driving the change and create and deliver programs in ways that our students and our communities are now expecting them. You know, this might not be really encouraging news at 8:30 in the morning, but I really believe we are going to thrive as an institution because we are going to do what we have always done. We're going to innovate. Innovation has been, I think, one of our watchwords. So it's my hope today during this symposium that we'll be able to have an opportunity to learn, to maybe question some of our assumptions, that we'll be able to share ideas, get to know each other a little bit better, and discuss ways that we need to work together to become one college. Obsessed, I really enjoy that word right now, obsessed with ensuring that our learners, many of who do not look like the majority of us in this room, to make sure that they are able to achieve their goals. So let's make certain that their future is our focus. So what I would like to do now is I would like to introduce to some and reintroduce to others. Here comes the boss.
Tim's and Dale, we just have a quick urgent message for you, Lola. Just okay. For a second. Tim?
Tim Sando. Yeah.
So I do have some breaking news. It's not exactly what I had hoped for. I've been combing the campuses for a petty cash drawer in hopes that I would find a few million dollars. I haven't done that yet, but I would encourage you to look at all the cushions and chairs throughout the campuses and look for the coin. We could really use it. But I do have even more exciting news. There's someone here today that tomorrow we'll celebrate a very special birthday. This state, no. I have a lot of witnesses. This is an individual, you're probably connecting dots at this point, but this is an individual that doesn't want the recognition. This is an individual that will take a student to the hospital. This is an individual that will cook dinner for a sick employee and take it to their house. This is an individual that will visit employees at the hospital. This is an individual that will spend and visit during an employee's hospice care and spend time making sure they have a friend with them. So this is somebody that gives much of themselves about 20 hours a day. So I would like to take this opportunity to embarrass this individual. And tomorrow, he has a very special birthday. So would you please join me in singing happy birthday to Dr. Ski?
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank you.
This looks familiar.
Happy birthday to you.
Thank you. Thank you. You know, it's true, in an academic institution, you can't keep anything a secret. Thank you all very, very much. So now, in all seriousness, we're really preparing them for you, Dr. Dyer. It's the cane that's in the way. I'll have years to get used to that. So thank you very much, Tim. I appreciate that. So now I have the distinct honor. Can we get back on track? Is that okay, Cavill? Are there any more? So I have the distinct honor to introduce to some and reintroduce to others, Dr. Ron Dyer. Where's our York campus? Would they kind of shout out for Dr. Ron Dyer? Where's our York? Here we go. Okay. Ron, all your friends are up in the top over there, okay? So you can find a complete biography about Dr. Dyer. I think it's on page 3 that'll talk about all of his accomplishments. And so I will not repeat those. But what I do want you to know is that he has become a friend not only to me, but to many on the York campus. And so, Ron, we're delighted that you're with us today. We really looked forward to this for months. And so we want to let the rest of the group know who don't know you. Ron is a zealot, a hack zealot. He is unbelievably engaged with his community in Dallastown in the York area. He serves as a York campus advisory board member. He is a big proponent of career and technical education. I see Steve Newcomer is there, so Steve's pretty excited. Steve is in our HVAC program there, Ron. He is a huge, huge proponent of our Hack Academy that happens on our York campus. And I have even heard him promote Hack late at night, Kathy, at the Leadership York events. So thank you, Ron, for being one of our marketing and admissions counselors. He is an avid reader, and you are going to realize that this morning. He's very fit. He enjoys CrossFit and all types of training. He plays golf, and he also plays the keyboard. And so maybe, Ron, if there's time, we'll get to hear a few of your songs. But ladies and gentlemen, a lot of thought, a lot of reflection has gone into the preparation for this presentation this morning. And we are honored, Ron, that you have chosen to be here with us and talk to us about disruption and what it is meant in your professional life at Dallastown. And so, ladies and gentlemen, I'm wondering if you would join me in giving Ron a warm, grateful hack welcome.
Thank you very much for having me today. I come to you very humbly as a K-12 superintendent who served as a second grade teacher, a fourth grade teacher, a teacher of the gifted, principal at 3 different schools. My last position was as director of elementary education for a very large school district in Virginia. I graduated from Slippery Rock, but there weren't jobs in 75 and I went south. And actually it was good because I got to see the South at a time when it was reinventing itself. Talk about a disruption. Major disruption at a time, whatever you want to call it, desegregation, integration, and we were bringing people together. I began my career in the formerly black elementary school in that county, and there was a lot of history there and a lot of finding where the direction should be. So I was part of a creative disruption from the very beginning and didn't know it. But to be honest, it has informed my work ever since. And so I come to you today with some of that. And then it was our desire, if you're a Pennsylvanian, how many of you are Pennsylvanian, native Pennsylvanians? Okay, if you're like me and you go elsewhere, you want to come back. So in 2005, by a gift of God, I got to come back and be part of Dallastown. We had friends and family in the York community, and it was a dream come true. I was assistant superintendent, and then in the middle of a meeting 7 years into it, I became superintendent. Talk about another creative disruption. So I have some stuff to talk about, and I'm going to jump right into it because I want to build a context for disruption. It's not always what you think it is. So when we open this thing up and we get our heads wrapped around it, I want to share something from a book that I read a few months ago. And our literacy person here, you're a teacher of English, isn't that correct? A professor of English for 40-some years, the gentleman I met earlier. I hope you will enjoy. Yeah, there he is. I enjoy very much getting to know some of your faculty before we begin this presentation. But this is from a book called Joyful, and a very interesting creative disruption. To build a context for it, I would like to read her words. I can't capture them any better. So, a place where this power of color really came to light was in Tirana, Albania. And this was a place that was trying to find itself after the Soviet bloc came apart, and it wasn't good. The people were not prepared. Those of you who teach this, you can explain it better than me. But they were trying to find themselves. And so there was a mayor, and his name was Edi Rama. Edi Rama was elected to the mayor position in 2000, and he was looking around at this and saying, what can I do? So here's what she writes. Looking at the empty treasury, he didn't have much to work with, so he decided to paint the buildings in downtown Tirana with vibrant colors. And in the wake of this painting project, things began to happen. People stopped littering in the streets. Shopkeepers started to remove the metal grates from their shop windows, saying that the streets felt safer, even though there were no more police on the streets than before. Crime began to fall, and people began to actually pay their municipal taxes. The number of businesses in Tirana tripled in the 5 years after the paintings, and the tax revenue increased by a factor of 6. And all of this revitalization began with just a few colors placed in the middle of a city. It's amazing. You can see the old, you can see the new. Look at that. Vibrant. All over the place. Now they reinvented their city with something as simple as color. You see, disruptions can be all different kinds. And I want to talk about another disruption that occurred. As you know, there was a little baby boy who was born at a time that it was not a good time to be a little baby boy. They were being eradicated. His mother was terrified, put him in a little basket, put him in the Nile. And right down past some reed bushes was Pharaoh's daughter, who picked this baby up and took it to the palace. Well, she said, I need a nursemaid. Anybody a nursemaid? Well, his mother happened to be by. I can do that. So here he goes into the palace. His mother is his nursemaid, and he is receiving the best education, the best of everything in the land. But he gets to a point where he doesn't like the abuse given to his people. And when that occurs, he sees something that he didn't like. It inflamed him, and he ended up killing one of the guards. He thought he got away with it, till somebody a few days later said, we saw you kill that guard. Ran to the wilderness for 40 years, not sure what would happen, and then he was called to lead a people. You know the story. I don't want you to think you made a wrong turn and all of a sudden ended up in a Sunday school lesson. But it's a powerful story because it informs us about a creative disruption that we're living in. It's the United States of America. His story and what occurred there in leading the people, of course, that disruption was created by God. But the pilgrims wanted to come over and others to find a new place in this land, a creative disruption. Our founders got inspiration from this man. And you'll see that we have that. Here's one of them. And just a few pictures of him around our country. And it kind of dawned on me one day as I was researching for a Sunday school lesson, and I thought, you know, there's a real secular piece to this, and we don't often see it. So here he is in the House Chamber of Commerce. This is from Leviticus, to proclaim liberty throughout all the land and to all the inhabitants thereof. What inspiration for our creative disruption. Representing light and law, maybe you know from your studies of Moses, what happened was he would listen to every case that was a problem in the land of Israel. So people could come to him personally. I'm having a problem with this person. He stole this. That. He would hear all those cases, and he got nothing else done. So his father-in-law came to him and said, you got to change this, and recommended a series of courts, in effect, before it would get to him. And guess where our legal system found its basis? That system. Isn't that amazing? And we see here a Statue of Liberty. Here's the French created this for us. They saw the frustration that we had. And what do we do and how do we go? Because it was a country growing, trying to find itself, birthing pains, all of that. But they sent us a symbol of hope and freedom based on Moses. Look at the stars around the head. It's him coming down off Sinai. Look at what she's holding, tablets. And look at the right arm, the lamp of freedom. Isn't that amazing? Even another country realized our creative disruption and gave us a symbol of strength. Now, that leads us to us. We are in a period where, I want to say, a tsunami has hit at least K-12 public education, but I have a feeling it's also at your level. I'm not going to read a speech to you, but I do have some notes, and I have the tendency to digress, so I don't want to digress. My time is very tight, and I want to make sure I stick to the message. But as we embrace the changes that we are required to embrace, because things are happening at warp speed, I say to my people, a tsunami has hit public education K-12, and there are people in our business that don't even know they got wet. I am serious. There are a whole lot of things here, and I'm not talking about just technology, a whole lot of other things. So what do we need as we go forward? I bring this up to my people and talk to them about it. And are we doing this? Are we not doing this? What pieces of it do we feel comfortable with? Let's talk about it. I go back to my time in 1975 when the South was coming out of and creating a whole new history. I wish we would have had some of these words. I'll be honest with you, that disruption, though dialogues didn't occur for 20 years later. And at that point, there's been a lot of frustration. I encourage you to be part of the dialogues now so that that doesn't occur. And that's what I've told people in my school division. We have to be an adapter. We have got to be a communicator. Well, we're educators. That should come easy for us. We are thinkers. We're into academics. Whatever your level is, you've had to make adaptations to make something work. New computer program. We're talking about the angels of the school district. And when I talk to my classified staff, they are my angels. They somehow make it work. And I know there's three of you here. Maybe there are a few others. I don't know how you do it, but it's just done. Talk about adaptation on a daily basis multiple times. Am I lying? It's true, right? So talk to them. They have it all figured out. And they run the place, whether you know it or not. A visionary. You know, I've given you just in the first few minutes some things to talk and think about. You know, some visionary things that a mayor of Albania, Moses, the founders of our country, the pilgrims, others. So you have visionaries, and they're right here in this room. And I'll come back to that many times. A learner. There, at the end of this, we'll talk a little bit about what can sustain ourselves on the journey of learning. And it's the learning process. And you know how that is. I was not great in math. I love reading. I love music. I love stuff like that. I love sciences. But for whatever it was, put me in a statistics class and give me the Valium. But no, seriously, just I need something. It's just to build the schema and that stuff, that whole first semester, I really struggled with to make sense out of it. And interestingly, I had that when I took geometry. And I kept approaching it like a class in mathematics. And if they would have just said to me, it's a class in logic, I think I would have got it. Just how my mind works, okay? But a learner, the learning process, there's some stress in it. There's some grappling with that. There's some growing, finding the schema to make it work, the connections. And who are your friends with that? You might have a whole different set of friends in statistics than you have when you're taking English Lit. All those things apply to what you're working through as well as what I'm working through. You're talking about a risk taker. I'm going to talk about what our district did. And I approached it like we cannot fail. And that's a whole nother topic I'd like to talk about. We cannot fail in this business. And when they go through, and I'm sorry for business people here, I'm not trying to offend you because I know that businesses fail. But more and more and more and more, they can't. They don't have the resources for it. You can't recover from it. It's same here. So the idea of having a pre-mortem before you take that risk is critically important. You know post-mortems, but a pre-mortem is, let's imagine we failed with this initiative. What were the factors that caused us to fail? That's a pre-mortem. And you think about that. That holds a lot of power for the change that you're going through and certainly for the redesign that I went through. All will help you with risk-taking. And finally, a collaborator. again, we are all educators. We have classrooms full of kids. We have at every level who are involved in collaborative work. Then we need to do that at this level too. So with that as a backdrop, I'm going to talk a little bit about what we did, but I want to digress for a moment. Yes, I am a big, proud proponent of HACC. I am thrilled with your president. I follow him on Twitter, and I'm exhausted at 9:30 a.m. You know, he's plowed in a snowstorm the whole campus. He has rode his bike through some path he's made. He's gone to 5 campuses. He's had breakfast with 2 mayors. I mean, it's just amazing. And that's just the morning. So the other night he calls me and he said, well, you know, and it was like 9-something at night. And I was, I'm also a church choir director, so I was just getting out of church and thought, let me call him back. But I listened to the message. He says, but I'm just getting on the Stairmaster. Stairmaster. This morning, he's texting me at 5-something in the morning, which I happen to be up. And he's getting ready to exercise again. I don't know how he does it. But what I will say to you is he is deeply invested in you, in the students, in your purpose, and what you're about. And for a school superintendent, makes me very easy to support him in what he's doing. Now, you have to understand that's my connection as a school superintendent to the college president. I know that my kids, when I'm writing those checks out to HACC Academy, are getting the absolute best. But there's something else you need to know. I was just at Kinsley. You know Kinsley Construction? You see their trucks? And this all started with Bob Kinsley raking grass, and he has built this incredible company out of it. But he has it right. He is down there building apprenticeships, and then what happens? They get into the construction business, and he is smart. He gives them 32 HACC credits. He wants his people to not only know their business, whether it's HVAC or construction, building, putting on roofs, or site work. He wants to make sure that other leg is developed, smart. More partnerships like that, look for him. That's a visionary, visionary manufacturer. And they're all over the place. Pretty soon, and I keep saying this to my district, there is going to be a sense of desperation in the manufacturing community, because manufacturing is coming back to South Central PA. We have great workers. Pennsylvania Dutch, they work. I mean, there's no question about it. And they're devoted to it. You go in these schools and you see how well they're cleaned, and that you don't know that they're 50, 60 years old. I mean, they polish the great care, love, quality. They see that, and they're coming here. I have businessmen and women who are coming to us saying, we need the kids. We need the kids. We had a junior class symposium 2 weeks ago, and all of our junior class were part of it. We had, I think, 103 businessmen and women there, and 6 kids were hired off the table. Another one said, we need welders. Well, guess what? HACC does that. We need auto technicians. You know, Toyota of York was there. We don't just need technicians. We need salespeople. Well, HACC is there with auto tech, and I got kids going to that. All this you're thinking and doing, great connections. Look for the needs. Manufacturing is roaring back here, believe me. And our workforce is not there. How do we do that and still keep the college component? I don't know your business like you know your business. I am just looking at it from my perspective as a school superintendent to help you conceive and visionize your business. I could talk the entire talk about this page, but there are some other things I want to talk about. And that is that in my life, 2 weeks before 9/11, my daughter had a mosquito bite and had viral-borne encephalitis, which is like 3 or 4 concussions. And we're talking about a very gifted, bright young lady who was not the same. And her high school career was in shatters. I had to find her eligible for special education and all of that. But when she graduated, I was already an adjunct professor at Northern Virginia Community College. And I went, we're going to NVCC, you know. And I'm telling you, they took her in, met her where she was, and developed an incredible young lady who then went on, when we moved up here, she went to Millersville, chemistry major, biology minor, not too shabby, well prepared by NVCC, and she would have done the same here if she lived here at the time, but she was in Virginia, and then went to VCU, nursing degree, and now a nurse practitioner. I come back to the community college for doing that, and I knew it because I was teaching there. I saw the articulation agreements. I saw the devotion and care of the staff. It was better than any high school, and I was part of a public school district at the time, as you know. You have such care, devotion, and advocacy for your kids. Keep that, okay? So I'm not preaching at you, I'm just telling you. This is what I see, all right? So this is the last part of it, though, is the most important of all, one who models. That you, when people look up to you, they will take their cue from you. And if you're modeling it, if you're modeling these things, they have no excuse but to follow that. So I bring that to you. And that's one of the reasons why I am such a big proponent of the community college system. Now, in our school district, I became superintendent overnight. We were coming out of the Great Recession, and things weren't going all that well. Millions of dollars worth of deficits. I had to implement a modified job freeze the next day. We did save $1.4 million. Now, I don't know exactly what your budget is, but I'm sure my budget is not anything like yours. But that was major for us. We were tipping about $90 million budget at that time. $1.4 million is a lot of money. It still wasn't enough. I had $3 million more. And I had millions upon millions upon millions of dollars worth of this because of the PISR system. Now, we did not create that problem. Are you part of PISRs? Okay. We didn't create that problem. And we didn't create the fact that it wasn't funded well. But boy, did we inherit it. And the CFO, I met him earlier. And I don't want to digress into all of this. But, you know, so, hi, everybody. I'm your new acting superintendent. And I'm making your life difficult. I am so sorry. But you know what? We didn't do that. We tried to look, same here. The answers are in this room. What can we do? How can we do it? And as I was saying to Tim, right? Okay, I was saying to Tim, we pulled the lights out of the vending machines. Like, why are we paying for that? They should be paying for that. You know, the stuff in there was colder than anything you find in your refrigerator. Get the degrees down a little bit. I mean, we did everything. The lights, the gas, the heating, you know. I found a school that was hundreds of thousands of dollars worth of utility bills. And I said, why? It's a brand new school. Well, we found out they were only using electricity and not using gas. Fixed that, saved $300,000. I mean, this is all in there. And as I said, I won't digress on that, but I modeled how can we squeeze more out of it to save more for our kids. And boy, that created a tidal wave. Okay, so I put that out there because I felt we had some real issues with what was happening in K-12. I'm back to the tsunami. Things were changing at a very quick rate, as you know, in the retail environment. And that's going to be interesting to watch because when you get into your generational breakout session, they call it Generation Z. I don't know if that's true or not, but they're 7 to 22 years old. And that group, though, is very different from the millennials. They like shopping malls. They like to touch things. They're not so keen on technology with some of this stuff. Okay, now what are retailers going to do when that group moves into its 20s and 30s and hordes, and there aren't shopping malls and there aren't stores like we know it? Retail alone has that to think about. How are they going to do that? And they're not so keen on Amazon. Or maybe what they'll do is they go to a store, they check it out on the store, and then they'll go on Amazon. So here's retailer feeling like they are schizophrenic. Here's where I can't even imagine. Ours is not that bad, despite what we might think. It's not that bad. I can't imagine how you plan for it. But we do know that students are changing. They're not waiting to learn. They're becoming increasingly entrepreneurial about their learning. They aren't waiting for anybody. And to be honest, I think that's the way it ought to be. When you and I went to school, I'm sure even for fairly recent people, we were told, well, we'll get to that second semester. We'll look at that. If you get into AP English, you'll study that. And on it went. How many of you heard things like that when you were growing up? Yeah, sure. Meanwhile, you know, I got in trouble because I read to the end of the book and you were only supposed to read one story at a time. Remember that? Okay. All right. I wanted the whole thing. Or when you went in and they had the overhead projector and they would only show you things. Like, show me the whole thing. You know, I think I can handle it. All right. That's how we were structured, and it was given to us when we were ready. And I have to admit, when I taught second grade, I did some of that, okay, for focus. But, you know, that's not how the kids are. They go right out there, and guess what they do? All right? So I talk about there being a lot of change here, and I don't want to get too far ahead of myself. Just let me make sure. We have talked about disruptions, creative disruption, but there was an excellent book written by Francis Fukuyama of George Mason University a couple decades ago. And he talked about the Great Disruption, 1960 to 1990. Now, Ski is younger than I am, but only by 6 years. We grew up in the most heady of times. And some of it was horrifying. The cities on fire, the assassinations, the uprisings. The whole society needed to change. Talk about a disruption. There were people who led creative disruptions. They're nonviolence. I can get into all of that. Powerful, compelling stuff. But when you think about it, 1960 to 1990 was a great disruption. If you enjoy reading, his essay talks about moral, ethical, all kinds of factors, not just political. And I was actually surprised by that. You know, it's not often that you see people who will tackle moral, ethical, spiritual kinds of things in an essay. Well, I believe that we have had the second great disruption. And for those of you who are essayists, you could tease this out better than I. You could say it was the war on terrorism. I don't say that at all. I say it's this. This is the great disruption. Kids aren't waiting to learn. And it's changed retail. It's changed a whole lot of stuff, and I'll talk a little bit more about that later. This great disruption is powerful for us, and it makes us have to rethink our business, particularly K-12. Now, I've gotten to a point, though, that when I'm hosting an office meeting, I have to tell them to put it away because they will be there, and people do not multitask. So I have to have a little bit of focus there. But I find it even at the administrative level. For us, an emergency where we used to be able to control, talking about control things, forget it. The video is going on, they're texting their parents. I mean, it used to be that we would be in total control of that. Nothing. And much of it that comes out makes us look like fools when we aren't. Okay, so that's a whole nother dynamic. So looking at that, I just have to say a few things, though, that are important. All of this is going on, but we have got to stay true to our values and to what's important. In my business, with all of that going on, I can't lose sight of this. And I want to share you something that brings us home at our level.
Evening.
Evening.
Can I ring that up for you?
Yes, please.
Have a good evening. It's up to the A.
A, B, C, D, E, F, G. No, not good.
Just use that word's neck.
Cat, dog,
calamari.
Trash on the beach. Good.
Farm fresh.
My son and I mow the grass. Yes, three times. I read your book.
You read my book?
Mm-hmm.
That's our business. It breaks me up every time. With all the swirl that we have going on, we have to still remain true. And that's true at your level also. There are fundamentals that you have to teach that have to be part of your rigor, have to be part of your course, have to be part of your way. And for my job, I need to make sure that everybody is still literate. We shouldn't have that. A beautiful story, but there should not be that. 100% of my kids should be reading and accessing text and being ready for what you have. So I show this, in fact, I'm going to show it again to my faculty, to keep us focused on the real work, okay? But somehow, we have to expand it, because coming up for us was the kids have all these other things that they can access. They're more in control in their learning than ever before, and they want to lead themselves into new places. They want to come to you and strike out and say, okay, I want this, I want that, and I want this. Can you build a program for me? And all of this is ahead, okay? So seeing that at my level, I had to look at redesigning secondary education. And can you imagine how popular that was? You know, we were a great high school of the 1990s. They thought they were a great high school of 2020. We are now a great high school of the 21st century. But at the time, we had some work to do. And we had 42-minute classes, which kids were racing around, and they were, you know, going from class to class. Well, for those of you that were in high school, we'll play this in just a moment, Justin. For those of you in high school, by the third or fourth class, you were really brain dead. You know, it was, you get the kids in, you know, it's 5 or 7 minutes. Where's what, da-da-da-da, coming in, there's an announcement. Maybe you get 20 to 25 minutes. The kids, 7 minutes before the period ends, they're looking at the clock. They're already thinking they're going to see their girlfriend, their boyfriend, whatever. You know, they got to hook up with somebody here, and that, you know, we got this coming up. And so it maybe you had 20 to 25 minutes. Meanwhile, all this other stuff is going on in society that we need to be teaching these kids and also respecting. So, you know, I said, we've got to rethink that. And the type of student who's out there who has taken charge of their learning is one like this. This is a 3-year project done outside of school by the student. You will notice when you watch him how he changes, how he matures. And then partway, it goes click, and he goes backwards. This took incredible thinking, planning. And then the story that he's telling, make a supersonic man out of me, don't stop me now, becomes our theme song. And I thought with Bohemian Rhapsody out there making the rounds, you'd enjoy it. Justin, would you?
Tonight, I'm gonna have myself a real good time. I feel alive, and the world turning inside out. Floating around in ecstasy, so don't stop me now. Because I'm having a good time, having a good time. See the sky, moving to the sky, like a tiger, looking by the laws of gravity. I'm a racing car, like Lady Gaga. I'm gonna go, go, go. There's no stopping me. I'm burning through the sky. 200 degrees, that's why they call me Mr. Fahrenheit. I'm traveling at the speed of light. I wanna make a supersonic man out of you. Don't stop me now. I'm having such a good time. I'm having a ball. Stop it now. If you wanna have a good time, just give me a call. Stop it now. I'm a good time. Stop, stop it now. I'm a good time. Don't wanna stop at all.
Is that amazing? That's the anthem of our youth today. Don't stop me now. I wanna learn everything I can. as soon as they can. And they can. They have access. So I look at that as an inspiration to you. I'd hire that kid. You want that kid in your class. 3-year project. I just thought that was amazing. I hope you got as much out of it as I did. So when I was looking at my high school, he was not our student, by the way, but I see other students out there. We had a science student who went to a bunch of labs in our county and couldn't get into them, so went down towards Johns Hopkins, and they let him in to do some work. He had his own project that he wanted to do. I couldn't believe that he couldn't get into a York County lab, okay? And he went on to do stuff. Kids and I look in our science fair, and just what I see happening there. But this whole thing of coming back to a 40-minute period was wrong. So the first thing I put out was we need to control for the variable of time. And not only did we have that with 42-minute period, we had a culture of 88% or more students that are going to college. And that's not bad, and I don't want to lose that, okay? But how many of them are finishing college? 20-some percent of them are dropping out. Are they going to the right college? Well, if they were going to Hack, they would be, okay? Some of those that are 20-some percent are dropping out. Some others of those, it's not for them. Okay, so the last thing I wanted to do as superintendent was dismantle college. So please hear that loud and clear. But what I wanted to do was to look more at workforce and career and come on out of No Child Left Behind, which is 100% college readiness, well-intentioned but horribly misguided. You know, we have to undo this because we have sold this to the parents and to the kids. So in my district, we had kids taking 10 classes a semester, and in February, we're having breakdowns. Suicides, we even had a teacher suicide. Too much. And as superintendent, I could not allow that to continue. So I said, we need to control for the variable of time on several levels. One of them is not just the class, but they're not making the right decisions. 10 classes, 5 AP classes, trying to get scouts, church, synagogue, whatever they'd be involved in, you know, other kinds of clubs and activities, and balance all of that, and they were having breakdowns. They wanted to do everything, but were not equipped to make the decisions to do it. We had to help them. So we went out, we looked at high schools throughout America. We thought this through. We went to a trimester session, 5 classes, which is very similar to what the collegiate environment is, 5 classes a trimester, 68-minute period. And we were able to take our boys and girls and just settle that whole thing down. Discipline problems have decreased substantially. Engagement has risen. And we've been able to get into what I call the RPMs of learning, relevant, purposeful, meaningful learning, deeper than ever before. Don't forget about that, the RPMs of learning. It's a great little catchphrase. Am I doing okay, President Ski?
Yes, sir.
All right. I asked him to sit close and rein me in. So he might use that little thing he got for his birthday, and he can trip me with it, right? So I'm looking at this as a major, major, major concern. And I thought, but you know, I'm in a very conservative community, highly collegiate, oriented, you know, doctors, lawyers, people, colleges work for them. How do I make that change? So I took my leadership team and the school board through a book study called Inevitable, which is a Christopher Reeve statement. He talks about change being inevitable and what a courageous story he had. But anyway, it's called Mass Customized Learning, Learning in the Age of Empowerment. Now, mass customized learning just sounds to me like one of those catchphrases, so I'm not interested in that. I prefer the word personalized. How do we help with relevant, purposeful, meaningful learning with students who want to take charge of it, have projects and things that they would like to do, ways of communicating, such as Matthew Perrin did? How do we work with that? And this book gave us a way. And we decided, much like I'm sure you have decided or will decide, we were not going to throw the baby out with the bathwater, but let's change the bathwater. So our discussions, and it looks like your breakout groups today, kind of follow along with that. You're going to be looking at bathwater. Maybe that's something you can joke and kid about. But really, your baby, you know what your baby is. You know what your constituent is. How do you change the water around it? So we looked at that. We decided about the trimester. We also looked at a second leg, which was social-emotional. And you're finding this to be so true, just as I am also. I think this that what the American Psychiatric Institute is saying, what we are being faced with is not going to go away. At your level, you're seeing it, and I'm sure you're seeing it in droves as we are. Society is creating some of this. I don't know. I'm not a sociologist. I'm not equipped to get into it. All I know is what I'm faced with. And it's just incredible. Look at 157,000 children and young adults, 10 to 24, which is what we work with here, your group and my group, for self-inflicted injuries. Not good. And then also, there's this. And as a superintendent, that pains me tremendously. I could not continue and sleep at night doing what we have been doing. It worked very well for maybe 20% of our kids, but it was not working well for the other 80%. We needed to change the bathwater. So that was the second leg of the stool. The first leg, again, control for the variable of time. Second was, how do we work with guidance, social services, their needs, mental health needs? And part of that is counseling, helping boys and girls make good decisions about where are they going? You want college? Okay, what kind of college? There are plenty to choose from out there. Let's talk about that. And just because brother and sister, one's a lawyer, one's a doctor, where do you want? Well, you know, I would rather go to Hack Academy and study and do something there. Okay, that's what you want. But getting that stuff. So I had to change my counseling staff. That was easy. Okay. But I'll tell you what. I hired one counselor who used to work at Chippensburg, and she would counsel kids that were in college who didn't want to be there. Boy, did she help my high school faculty. Just saying. All right. We also looked at positioning of AP courses. Like, why were they all happening at junior, senior year? It's ridiculous. When I was in 1967, I took AP biology, and at that point it was junior high that I attended, so that was 7, 8, 9. So as a ninth grader, I came to the high school, followed their schedule, which started earlier, and we were there 45 minutes earlier than any of the other kids taking AP biology, and that was 1967, and that couldn't happen in my school district. That's ridiculous. So how do we open up things? How do we equity and access? Okay. You know, shouldn't AP be open to everybody? I mean, you self-select. Then you find out as if we're not for you. I mean, it's amazing how kids can rise to challenges. And I can go on. And then finally, the big three, the third one was about the RPMs of learning. And I keep saying that. Relevant, purposeful, meaningful. How do you engage them? They want to collaborate. How do you do it purposefully? What kind of experiences? How do you make geometry come alive? How do you... All these different topics. How do you make them connect with kids? And I bring this up, and the power of all of this, I just want to share with you just the environment in which we're working. It's changed to the point where each student is now a chief executive officer of their own corporation. And are we preparing them for that? You know, not only are they a chief executive officer, they're the CFO of their own corporation. They're their own HR director with short resumes and selecting jobs. They're also going out there and they have to figure out about retirement. They're going to need at least $2.3 million or more in 40 years. I can go on. All these things, and I said to our people, we aren't doing that. So we added financial literacy. We've added other pieces to it. And going to trimester has opened up the ability for meaningful electives and other courses to bring some of that home. They're also coming into world. That's really incredible about marketing. The largest taxi company owns no human-driven taxis. Which one is it? And who's the next one coming up? Lyft, yeah. Google that, download that app and look at your area and see all of a sudden what Lyft is doing. The largest accommodations provider, hotel or motel, owns no rooms. You got it. The most valuable retailer has no inventory. Watch out for this one. Alibaba. Amazon has inventory, okay? The most popular media platform creates no content. Facebook, okay? The largest movie house owns no cinemas. The biggest user of Twitter is Dr. Skeet. Yeah, we're done now, right? But look at this, Google, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter. The internet expanded at an incredible pace, and with the rise of Amazon, it's changed retailing forever. And when you think that apps didn't even exist 8 years ago, look at the industry that's come out of that. I mean, we were downloading a Lyft app yesterday after a couple of my senior staff says, you're traveling, you need to get Lyft because you're going to not find an Uber there. Go to New York City and it's heavily Lyft now. And now we're watching some other stuff, artificial intelligence, virtual reality, driverless cars, and SpaceX. It's happening at a very, very fast rate, all of this. And so you're in it. And as I'm closing here, I want to talk to you a little bit about how do you sustain yourself in the journey? Well, there are lots of things that you can look at. I suggest looking at personalizing learning. What can Hack do for you? I love a most important word in your name, and I've talked to Dr. Ski about this. Community. Market community like never before. Nobody else is doing community like Hack. Really, think about that. You live in it every day. You don't see it. Look at the possibility. When a child is baptized, they say, what name shall be given to that child? And there's a lot of talk about that name. And then you see the name all over the place. And then you work hard to pronounce people's names. The power of a name. The power of Harrisburg Area Community College. Community. Wow. Think about that. I'm just putting it out there. For us, our motto, our vision statement, became very important. It's to inspire and create pathways for student success. Inspire and create pathways, student success. Four key elements. We are creating pathways, and I'm proud to say the Hack Academy is one of them. Creating, okay, we've spent about 7 years on that. But now we need to go back to that first word. I'm not so sure we've done that yet, to inspire them. We're still fighting old decisions and decision structures. And you might be too. How do we inspire boys and girls to look at things differently through a different lens and look at options? That's where you come in and your community comes in and bringing them into your community. I'm just saying, you are in a very unique position to do that, powerful, to recapture where you are going and where do they fit in to your vision. And I love your mission statement, creating opportunities and transforming lives to shape the future together. Now, I understand this is under review, but look at these words, creating opportunities. You need to tease that out. Are you? To what extent? What other? You know, what aren't we getting to? Transforming lives. Are you? How do you know you're doing that? What quantifiable ways? And market that. We have to transform lives. We need everybody to be productive in the future. We have to. What's your role in that? And I believe your work today in your breakout sessions, and I'm just an outsider here who has taken my staff through similar things, is to unpack those key terms. And if those key terms aren't your key terms, find what your key terms are. And think about the baptism of a child. There's power in names. Your vision statement. Hack will be the first choice for a quality and accessible higher education opportunity. Wow. First choice. So how do you get it out there? How do you market that? How do you show them that it is the first choice? How do you parade your success stories? And there are many of them. Follow his Twitter feed. His culinary here. He's, yeah, oh my goodness, it's all over the place. And that's just one day. So he's, you know, right away, what are you doing? Were they their students' first choice? Why weren't they the students' first choice? My role in K-12 is to get it to be their first choice, if that is the right choice for them. Let's get the first choice. You don't have money to go exploring, you know, something else, and realize a year down the road, I should have gone to Hack. All right? How do you do? I don't have the answers to that, but in this room, you do. First choice for a quality and accessible higher education opportunity. I like both of those words, quality and accessible. And again, what do those mean? Where does this organization take those terms? How do you make those terms real and quantifiable? I would also say that, and these are things that I get in some other books, like Never Stop Learning, you know, take whatever time is needed to create your strategic plan. I made a major break with mine. I said to my assistant, we're going to lead strategic planning. It's not going to be a blank sheet of paper. We need secondary redesign. We have too many suicides. We have too many breakdowns. We are putting kids on treadmills that they're not equipped. They're not making decisions right. Shame on us if we don't lead that. And in we went and we sold it. And sometimes that's what it takes. Blow up the strategic planning process. I'm sorry, Dr. Ski. I hope that doesn't upset things. But I'm just putting it out there. I think you need to read a book called Loon Shots. I talked to you about this book. It's about people that were in organizations that couldn't get their agendas done, and people thought they were loony. Okay? And so you look at Radar. And here was a partnership that found Radar, by mistake, by the way, interesting story, and couldn't get any of our military to go with it. Now, here comes World War II barreling down. It just so happens that one of the inventors of Radar manipulated a way to get lunch with FDR's chief of staff. They had a 45-minute lunch. He showed him this stuff, talked about it, and then he took him down to the Naval Yard to show him. He's like, whoa, got him a 10-minute appointment with FDR, and the rest is history. And you know that England created all kinds of antenna systems, and it put Hitler out of business with his Luftwaffe, okay? But that's languished for 20 years. Statins. I'm on a statin. I won't ask how many of you are. That people who invented that, they thought it was loony. And now look at the lives that are being saved. I can go on and on and on. Now, I'm not going to ask you to raise your hand if you're a loony. But I bet some of you have some off-the-wall ideas. And you should be made comfortable in your community to bring those ideas down here to help in recapturing or moving ahead with your organization. Very inspirational book. And those are only two stories, so many more. And never stop learning. I just can't believe how people think they get to a point. And, you know, I've learned what I've learned. And I got to that point with my high school. And I love my people. But all of a sudden, there was this meeting. They invited me down. And we were all set to plug this in and roll it out. And it's Dr. Dyer, we need another year. And so I came down, 123 faculty members. And I said, why? Well, you know, we just need more time. Okay. What would you do with another year? Nobody could answer the question. So I said to them, well, you know, I understand that. You have spent 4 years developing this. If you could give me a good rationale for another year, I'd entertain it. So far, I'll be honest with you, I haven't heard it. Just you need more time. You've been out visiting some of the greatest high schools in America. Who's visited here? Change the whole discussion. You need to have the guts to come. Now, I could have been, oh, okay, I understand, and you're stressed, and we've had a lot of snow. No. Our kids were being denied something for those 4 years we were putting this together, folks. And I wasn't going to do it for another year. And we did it. Equity, access, the three legs of the stool. Controlling the variable of time, trimesters, length of course, looking at guidance, social services, real career workforce in the college planning, and the RPMs of learning, relevance, purposeful, meaningful. I hope that in this talk today, all I have tried to do is share with you one superintendent's journey in this thing called creative disruption. And I have had a heck of a good time leading it in my district, and I've had an even better time here with you today. Let me tell you, I've said it to you 5 times. The answers are in this room. You can do this. You can have the most incredible creative disruption going and put every community college in Pennsylvania on its side. What's happening there at HAC? That's what we're doing. We have people coming to us saying, how did you do it? Well, it wasn't easy. And manufacturers and other folks are coming down there saying, well, we know we can come to you because you'll do it. That's what you want. All right. This has been a complete pleasure for me. I do come to you humbly. I can't tell you your business. I can only share with you what we've done to try and find it. God's blessings to you and your continued work with the best resource we have on earth, and that is our students. Good luck to you. President Steve, thank you.
I'll do a couple breakouts. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Vince.
Yes. Yes. If there are any questions here. I know it's hard in a large room. Well, I understand that. But I do want to hit, yes, sir.
Has the 1 in 12 suicide rate changed?
Yes, it has. Unfortunately, this year we started with a suicide on Labor Day weekend, but it was not school related. Yeah. And that was a horrible way to start the year. But in terms of the number of suicidal ideations and actual suicides, that was one. We had had 3 and 4. And the number of ideations, weekends that, you know, you were thinking you were going to Giant to shop on Saturday morning and you weren't, you're flying to somebody's house. I mean, that stuff is all really decreased. So I have hope. Thank you. Thank you. Yes.
I find this talk really interesting because I have a student, I have a child that is a student that's a 10th grader. My question to you is how important are, I mean, I love what you spoke about, how you changed everything. How important are parents in this journey?
Well, I'm glad you said that because at the beginning, I had parents that were like, oh, so what do you do? We're not dismantling college. Let's get that off the table. And they had to hear that. But it was amazing how many of them started reflecting on the pressure at home. Okay, so that was number one. And the Facebook page, really, it was kind of fun to watch. They're onto something here. I mean, you know, so the supporters started coming out. The biggest thing that happened was this year. Now, we are the fourth year into this now. Remember, I've been 8 years superintendent. Took me almost 4 years to get it going. Now we're in our fourth year in the high school. 500 parents showed up at the rising ninth grade parent meeting. We normally have like 30 to 40. It's taken hold. They want to know all about the pathways. They want to, and we have created these pathways. I could go on. You have to stop me, okay? These pathways now, we have aligned so that, now there are core courses that you have to take. I mean, let's face it, okay, there's always English, math, whatever. But then, are you interested in medical? Now, this isn't Germany where you're locked into it at grade 6. But if you want to go somewhere in the medical field, it's everything from clerk, the angels of HAC, and the work that they do, to a specialized surgeon. What do you think? And we have 14 of those, and the 15th is undecided. But we start working with boys and girls in fourth grade, make some decisions in sixth grade, open up course planning in seventh grade, so that they can start looking at things. We're looking at pre-apprenticeships, apprenticeships, internships, credentialing. That's the next big thing for us, is credentialing. So it's taken hold. And we had somebody that came in and said, well, how come Dallastown doesn't have the highest PSSA Keystone? You know? Well, the parents were like, we don't care. I thought, that's what it's about. Those accountability things are not strong. Does that help you? It's taken hold.
With making so many changes to the school district, I'm sure that there were a lot of naysayers and people that weren't on board. What would you say was the biggest factor to getting them open to the idea of changing and getting them open, like jumping on board?
Well, let me tell you, I did something a little different. I went to the town councils, to the townships, to the boroughs. I went to those first. And that was amazing, too. Because the heads were nodding like, it's about time. And I got that crew on board first because they're, first of all, elected. They're going door to door, and they're talking about it. I made sure that our representative and the senator were engaged in it. Both of them were. And they, as constituents, well, what is Dyer doing to the school district? They were ready for that. And then my teachers, the vast majority to this day, wanted to make changes. They just didn't know how. And they also needed somebody that would be their shield and protector. I'll be honest with you. And once the teacher said, you know, Dr. Dyer doesn't, you push him, he doesn't do this. I stand firm on it. You want to go back to suicides? You want to go back to brain dead, stand and deliver? No, come on. You know, and once the taste was there, it was amazing. So it was a lot of townships and stuff. I did that first. I went into the faculty. We worked, we visited, and we had to do some curriculum rewriting. And then we sold to parents. And every meeting we had, the majority of parents walked out and said, this makes sense. This makes sense. But we could not fail. And you heard me say that earlier. We really had to think about what would be the factors that would cause us to fail if we allowed them to be. And some of that, which you raised, would be it if we didn't sell it right. Yes, ma'am. I'm sorry, you have?
Having so much success with your school district, have you offered to share your success with other local school districts in the area, and have they been receptive to that?
Yes. Last year, we all take turns as superintendents, being what we call chief of the chiefs, chief executive officer. So last year, that was my job. And so what I did was I brought in two book studies for them to talk about, and then we delved deeply into high school redesign. And that has continued even this year. Everybody's doing something, but what I did was for the entire high school, not for a subpopulation. And that's where I differ. I mean, this was really big risk to take an entire high school and flip a switch in a whole different direction. But otherwise, I believe it was not equitable and did not provide the opportunity and access to all of our students. That's my belief. You will find that a lot of districts are exploring stuff that's very controlled. At least they're exploring it. But I come back to my Southern experience, equity, opportunity, and access had not been there. Okay, yes. Good questions, Dr. Ski.
How did you keep the faculty engaged and not turn them off to the idea of creative disruption? Because a lot of people don't embrace disruption, but yet that's what needs to happen for extreme change to happen. So I think sometimes what we're seeing is the faculty are balking at, oh, don't change things on us. How did you get past that?
Well, it was interesting. I went to some, of course, I've been there for a period of time, so I knew some of the faculty members. And one guy had just bought a home. Home was circa 1976. And, you know, it was the kitchen that came with it in 1976. And he and his wife were in this little debacle about, she wanted to change it. It was just horrific. And he said, but it's all here. It's not a problem. So they went down to Home Depot and they came out with this plan for a kitchen that was just like, oh my gosh, you know, it's unbelievable. I said, Jay, would you share that with everybody? I looked for creative ways to show them that they're playing in that same sandbox in their own life. And so he did in front of the 140 some faculty members, said, you know, I'll tell you, I just went through this. Why aren't we doing that with our high school too? So I look for RPMs, you know, relevant, purposeful, meaningful ways to show them they're doing that in their own life. And it made a difference. I know that may sound silly, but I mean, people applauded. I have taken up, I asked Dr. Ski to sit next to me because he knows how passionate I am. And we share the desire to take our organizations to new places, and we're risk takers, and that's just how that is. But when you think about our country, can you imagine the risk they took? Nobody did this. Plato talked about it. I mean, and yet, yeah, okay, we've got some divisions, we've got some whatevers, but look at what you're giving to your students. That isn't found everywhere in the world. So you're on the right track. Change the bathwater if you need to, but don't throw that baby out. I know that you got to go. Okay, thank you.
I loved it.
Ron, thank you very much. We will remember RPM for sure.